And as the brethren of the Lord and Cephas, verses, or I only and Barnabas have not we power to forbear walking, who goeth a warfare any time at the own charges, who planted a vineyard and eateth not of the fruit thereof, or who feedeth a flock and eateth not of the milk of the flock. Say I these things as a man, or saith not the law the same also? Verse 9. For it is written in the law of Moses, thou shalt not muzzle the mouth of the ox that treadeth out the corn. Doth God take care for oxen? Or set we it all together for our sake? For our sake, no doubt, this is written, that he that plowed should plow the bow, and he that threshed in bow should be partakers of his oak. Verse 11. If we have sown unto you spiritual things, is it a great thing if we should reap your carnal things? If others be partakers of this power over you, are not we rather? Nevertheless, we have not used this power, but suffer all things, lest we should hinder the gospel of Christ. Verse 13. Do ye not know that they which minister about holy things live for the things of the temple, and they which wait at the altar are partakers with the altar? Even so as the Lord ordained that they which preach the gospel should live of the gospel. But I have used none of these things, neither have I written these things that it should be so done unto me. For it were better for me to die than that any man should make me my glorying void. Verse 16. For though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. For if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. What is my reward then? Verily that, when I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, that I abuse not my power in the gospel. Verse 19. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, that I might gain the more.
Praise the Lord. Let's stop here because of our time. Our time is highly limited. So we see the Paul the Apostle, he encouraged the Corinthian Christians. You know, he encouraged them and also made them to understand that there is need for self-denial. Paul the Apostle encouraged the Corinthian Christians' need for self-denial. Today, he's challenging you and me also for the same task, for the same self-denial. We see that without this self-denial, we'll cross the border, we'll go beyond the landmark, and we'll run out of the grace of God. By so doing, we go contrary to the will of God. But for us to continue, that self-denial has to come in. We have to adopt that self-denial. That is what is expected of us. You see, Paul the Apostle, he denied himself. He planted churches, he preached the gospel, he did a lot of things. Still, in the midst of that, they criticized him. They belittled him. They said all sorts of things. But what challenges me most is that, with all that, Paul continued. He did not let those things be said about him. He did not let those things to discourage him. He continued. He said that just as our pastor, when he was leading prayer, he said that when he checked the temperature this morning, it was around 30 something. At that point, you come up to help somebody. After helping the person will turn around and castigate you, say one thing or the other against you. When that comes to the idea, if you don't have that self denial, you will rise up and challenge the person. You will rise up and start doing things that is not, things that do not bring glory to the name of God. But Paul the Apostle, you see, Paul the Apostle planned. He did not reap that. He let other people reap. He did a lot of things and let other people have the good of it. So that is self-denial. Today, God is expecting you and me to do the same, that his name will be glorified. And Paul was holding that just for people to know him, for him to receive praise from them, because he knew that there is a reward. The greater reward that people will get. Today, you know, there are things we are fighting, we have to, you know, running after today that we get, that the earth can give us. But Paul looked beyond that. He knew that those things he planned that he did not reap, he is going to reap the greater than that at the end of the day. And we see that Paul apostle, all that he did, all that he planned, and that other people reaped that time, he reaped greater than that. Because if you make heaven, you have reaped all. Praise the Lord. So for us to make that, we have to, you know, this step that I have to come in, we learn a great lesson. And he asked them the question, you know, does it mean that they don't have rights to reap? He has the rights to reap. As a minister of God, you see, even if you look at the Jewish priests, they were fed by the things, you know, the sacrifice that were brought in the temple. So it's expected of the ministers today to be fed, you know, the church needs to take care of the minister. Because you see, Paul the apostle, even at that point, that is the command of God. For the minister of God to be fed by the sacrifice that was made in the church or to the altar. But you see, Paul, those things he did not even look at them. He knew that he challenged them. He told them that they had rights to do those things, but he did not. So that he, you know, that would not even discourage them. I pray that God will help us, that with that self-denial, we will start implementing it in Jesus' name. We have to do that in many ways. That is why sometimes when I start studying the Bible, I'll ask God to forgive me, because when you look at it, it's like a mirror. The moment you just open it, you see yourself in the act. You see yourself, you say, Lord, please, remold me, transform me, rebuild me. That is the only prayer we make at that time, because you don't have any excuse. Looking at what you read in the Bible, and looking at your life, looking at the thing, you have to go to your neighbor to ask God, please, have mercy on me. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. You see, with all those blasphemy, Paul spoke to them, boldly, he was bold, telling them the truth. He planted the vineyard, but he did not reap. He told them he had the rights to reap from those vineyards, but he did not. He had to preach it, because if he said, because he didn't reap it, and today he said, no minister should reap from what the vineyard he planted. He is plucking the gospel, but he preached it, despite that he did not reap from where the vineyard is, but he still preaching. So this is telling us that we need to express, we need to open the word of God so people understand. Praise the Lord. I learned a lot of things today, because Paul the apostle, you see, when he was talking to the people in the corner, he was bold. And why these people were castigating him? He received the vision because he's sincere. Praise the Lord. If you read Acts of Apostles chapter 18, verse 9 to 11, then speak the words to Paul in the night by a vision. See, and God told him, be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace, for I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee, for I have much people in this city. Praise the Lord. Because of his faithfulness, that's why he received that vision. But had he been Paul start fighting, he would be on his own. But God encouraged him that he should not be discouraged. I pray that God will help us, that we will start receiving such a vision. We start receiving a dream like that, a vision like that, a message like that, you're already on the right track. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Because of our time, we are going to quickly look at the topic in difference of heading. The first of heading is the leading man of a true minister. The leading man of a true minister. How do we know a true minister? You know a true minister when he lives according to what he preaches. And what is that he preaches? The message from God. When he lives, the things he preaches. Paul apostle is it. What he taught in Corinth, he goes to Rome, he leave it. He leave it in that same Corinth where he preached. He preached it in the morning, he leave it in the morning, he leave it in the afternoon, he leave it in the evening. When you look at Bible, even this, when I was looking at this, I stopped even preparing the message. I was feeding myself, because at a point, I was just listening, I was just getting a message. Praise the Lord. So we see that Paul the apostle, he preached this gospel and he lived it by example. Because his word, his life, everything he does that time becomes a message. You know, the Bible says that all people are looking at you, and life is a message to people. They look it through and through. And Whatever he preached, he never lived a life contrary to what he preached. So Paul's attitude, Paul's behavior, Paul's activities becomes a message to the people. That is what is expected of God. That is the mark, the true mark of God. And his desire and his goal is to win the soul of men. After he got saved, because he received the result when God arrested him, and when Jesus Christ spoke to him, he said, Paul, why thou persecuted thou me? He said, when Jesus Christ spoke to him, direct, and he gets converted. After that conversion, his primary goal that time is to win the soul. That is ultimate desire. You see, many people are called, but if you are choosing, there are many Christians out there, but only those who have the genuine experience of salvation, genuine experience of free from outward and inward sin, are those that are living the right life that God is expecting, those that have the self-denial. That is what is expected of a true minister. That is the true man. You don't preach air and you live being. It's not a true man. The true man is you live that which you preach. When I'm looking at this, I began to ask God to give me grace. Can I say, devil, we say devil. Devil is somewhere. He keeps throwing his arrow. There are things that, you'll be doing it, you say, it's normal, or it doesn't matter, it's normal. But if you look at the word of God, you see that it matters. It matters. And for you to be free from that, you have to go to the Lord in prayer and ask God to revive you, to renew you. Because you are looking at it with your outward eye. But if you look at it spiritually, look at it biblically, you know that actually you're already on the wrong track. And when I was preparing this, honestly, while I was asking God to forgive me, to please help me. Because on my own, I can do nothing. But with Him, I will run to the very end. I pray that God will help us, that we will continue to the very end in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You see, that the proof of a Christian, a true Christian minister, is for one to live. You preach it, you prove it. You tell people there is something here. Okay, can you show me a proof here? You go there and show them. We need to show through the life we live. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. The true proof that salvation, sanctification of, after you got saved, let the proof be to fight for salvation of the people outside. That is the proof of a minister. You are a minister, I am the minister. Sometimes you think that it's only pastor that God expects you to go out and preach. Go out and command us. At the moment you get born again, God expects you to go out and preach the gospel to every creature. And he that believes shall be baptized. I pray that God will help us. There are some writer write, he said, must I go and empty handed? Must I meet my Savior and empty handed? Must I go, without presenting the soul before God? But there is a saying that you have to have water in your stomach to be able to draw out water from the well. So we have to get converted first, before we'll be able to fight and seek for the conversion of the people outside. I pray that God will help us, that proof will be found in us in Jesus' name. Before we continue, let's quickly answer a second question, because our time is already fast spent. What are the proof of the true Christian ministry? Praise the Lord. Am I communicating? Praise the Lord. Yes, the proof of that true ministry is to live the life worthy of emulation, the life of Christ, the life that Christ has already tabled for us to follow. And for those that preach the gospel, they may preach it actually, but they don't live it. They don't have any proof of that the command of God. That is why you say, ask the question, should we continue in sin and grace my heart? Say, God forbid, I pray that we will never continue in that in Jesus' name. Let's quickly go to seconds of heaven. The laborer's wages of a true minister. The laborer's wages of a true minister. You see, when you minister, when you see that self-denial, there is a reward, there is a wage. Those that run the race, they run the race that at the end, they will receive their wage, they will receive their gain, they will receive the crown of a true minister. You will never preach the gospel, you will never win the soul and go empty-handed. you must be rewarded. And the reward that comes from God is the greatest thing that one can get. Because the else we are in here can give you promotion, can give you money, can give you health, houses, you know, other things that we consider as a pleasure here. But the soul cannot rescue you. The only person that can save your soul is our Lord Jesus Christ. And for you to be that, you have to follow the steps that God has already set for us to follow. There is a step, you have to be born again. Before born again, you have to realize that in yourself, you confess yourself, get born again, sanctified. That is the way to go. When you follow all those steps, you see that at the end of the day, you will receive the wages that God has set for his people. Even so, and the Lord ordained that those who preach the gospel should live of the gospel. It is the command of God. That is the command of God. Those that preach the gospel, even in, as I said earlier, the Jewish priests, we are maintained at the sacrifice offered, you know, certainly, that offered. So certainly the ministers of Christ, the men of God will have to be our pastors, you know, it's our responsibility. It's the responsibility of the church to take care of them. When I was preparing this, a lot of questions began to fly into my mind, and just reserve it. I will throw the question one day. I don't want to say that because already our time is up. So the ministers of Christ should be maintained by their own ministry. I will not have a minister here and expect people from Celestial Church to take care of him. Will be a taboo. We'll have a minister here, expect Muslims outside there to be taking care of them. And our ministers, we need to take care of them. It's our responsibility. Honestly, take it from me, it's our responsibility. And we have to. Because in that aspect, I have to say it, we are very, very powerful. Very, very powerful. I have to say it. But I pray that God will help us. Like today, after this thing, we will repent. And I pray we will repent in Jesus' name. Our minister, if I don't know if any of the pastor have ever come to you, say, please, I have this need, help me. I don't know if there's any. But I think it's not a human being. The way you have your ambition, you want to have this, it's a human being. You have the responsibility, the way you have your responsibility, that is how they need to have. They have bills to pay, they have other things, some more than us. So it's our responsibility. We will not be able to pastor, I have so much pain, pray for me, pastor, my head is aching, then my mouth, my nose, I eat with diagnosis, and this is my stomach has not been the same. We keep praying for you, fasting, praying. Whatever Bible makes us understand, even those things we give to them as a return is even carnal compared to what they are giving to us. I read something that a brother posted on Facebook, that when we take care of our instructors, they have our bosses in their work, our supervisors, the way we take care of them, the way we respect them, the way we put them in a very good line. If we are to put our ministers, if we are to have that respect, if we are to take care of our ministers, this will not be the same. Because we are too familiar, that familiarity, too close, you say, that is his responsibility, that is his duty. I pray that God will help us, that thing will go out of our mind in Jesus' name. And we will repent. This is a message coming to you and me this morning. Because of our time, let's quickly go to the next subheading, which is titled, and my time is already up, which is titled Liberty, Subjugation to Divine Glorification. We're going to take our text. Let's open our Bible to the book of Romans, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, from where we took our text. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I just want to read verse 16 to 19. For though I preach the gospel and have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me, yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. For if I do these things willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, the dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me, what is my reward then? Verily that when I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, that I abuse not my power in the gospel. For though I be free from all men, yet I have made myself a servant unto all men, that I may gain the more. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. It's our responsibility to preach the gospel. that responsibility to preach the gospel, because if we preach the gospel, we should not expect men to glorify, to thank us. We should not expect any glory from men. Some people, some ministries today, I don't know if you are watching some Christian channel, you see, they will preach, at the end of the day, they will start asking congregation, how is my preaching? How is it? Am I vibrant? Am I eloquent? Start asking the people, if you want men to praise them, to, you know, people will start posting on that channel, on that session. People will start posting, you do this, the way you move, the way. So, if whenever they're preaching, they're expecting what people will say about them. That is not what Paul, that is not the Paul's mission. Paul's mission is that if we preach the gospel, that the name of God only will be glorified. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. That is why he said he planted a vineyard, but he did not eat from it. He made them to understand, oh, he will do all those so that only the name of God will be glorified. And some people look at his life, they start crying. They start giving glory to the men of God today, some of them. If you look at them, you see with all these challenges passing through, and he still continues, you begin to give glory. Say, thank God for this man, thank God for this woman. And the glory goes to God. That is what God is expecting of us. I pray that God will help us in Jesus' name. Let's go to the morning prayer, because already my time is up. Let's begin to pray that God will help.